and then look at the current full costs redirected from the current budget at the moment, which starts off at 118,980 and end up in 1,937,960. It's a big leap. Is the cabinet member confident that he will be able to reach this kind of revenue that is required to meet that shortfall, given that the council is really struggling at the moment through the highways department to try and raise revenue through advertising on the highways?
I did. It took 2 goes from what I got there. I think this is, and I suspect everyone would appreciate, this is phenomenally different to advertising on the highway. I think when you come into the church estate, there is the opportunity of advertising on plaques. There isn't the opportunity currently available to advertise to every single resident on the borough and every single business. I think it really, it's a phenomenally different product, essentially, that would be available for people. So yes, I have confidence in those figures. Clearly, it's down to the result of the tendering process. I would very much like to see local people benefit from that. I believe that local people will benefit from this decision as we get to advertise services and opportunities available to them. I can't guarantee that will happen through the tendering process, but I'd be very keen to see as best possible local firms and local businesses, local people rather, benefit from what the publication is.
You talk about reaching people, and I'm all for reaching people, and as you know, as you do, and we do all that, and most of us all have to. But we have opportunities here where we've talked about, you know, you've got the messengers, okay, they don't go across everywhere, but they are quite a lot. We've got the Globe, we've got the Globe Online, we've got the News, we've got the Echo, all have online platforms. We have our partner agencies, police, fire, housing associations, job centres, community centres, libraries, one-stop shops. We can get information to all of them. Why do you believe it is still necessary to get a monthly publication? And second part of it, how monthly? You know, the government guidance is quarterly, you've got a monthly, some people, you know, try it weekly, fortnightly. Why did you determine monthly?
To the first point about engaging with all of our partners and everybody that delivers services on the world to get that information across. I was at the Rural Partnership meeting last week, and there are services provided right across the world, and there are people doing their best to engage with the residents. I don't think that currently the number of residents we need to be meeting are the number of residents that we need to be engaged. That's the value from our advertising spend. I don't think we're reaching that. And it's all well and good for some residents in some areas to feel well informed. But when I am being told that the very poorest residents are not, then I'm not content. And I said before, and I'll repeat again, advertise across every single publication, on every single platform, specifically online, and you will not reach every resident. And that, for me, is the issue we must tackle. In addition, the second question was about why would we go monthly. As you're aware, we need to do a number of things. If I think monthly is the best option to communicate the positive community work being done across the borough, it's an opportunity to meet the advertising need for things like shows at the Thorpe Pavilion, for advertising things like jobs. It is, and this was, we had a discussion about this, it is at the right level to deliver the value that we need our town to deliver.
Did you want to come back in?
Yes. Yeah, just very briefly, thank you, Jim. Has this approach been adopted elsewhere? Has it been seen to be successful? Are we going to learn from mistakes that the council's made?
Yeah, that's very good. whenever I went down to visit her, she was always complaining about this. And when I saw her last year, she's raised this with me, sort of last year, she actually raised the fact that she now knows what's going on. So I think, I mean, clearly to one person it's anecdotal, but in terms of the things that have come to me, so my grandmother was particularly positive about this. But yes, I think that the lessons we can learn from other areas doing this are plentiful. I think that they have delivered great success in areas, and I think we would look to replicate all of those positives.
Just a quick supplementary.
Thank you, very quick.
Extremely quick. The call them into great play the bench, communication. I understand that the £48,000, which is mentioned in the call, was actually consultation costs and it was never brought to court. I just wonder what knowledge do you have of that particular case? What's mentioned in court?
I don't particularly want to get into the order of
Greenwich. Excuse me, Matthew. That's a question that should really be answered by the head of legal services who's coming up later.
Okay.
Can I say, I've given the committee plenty of latitude here because this is an important issue. I've got three more people who've indicated they'd like to speak, and all three people have asked questions before. I think Matthew's had more than a grilling here. So I think I'm going to call a halt now to questions that have been asked. I've given people plenty of latitude. The three people who've indicated they want to ask a question, I've all asked questions in the past.
And
Ron. No, you'll have to leave it now, Ron, I'm sorry. Matthew, I've just said you'll have to leave it now, Ron, like it or not.
Chairman, if I may.
This
is very important, yet you want to quell debates? I find that incredible that we have a call in, and you want to quell debates. Unbelievable.
Councillor Blakeley, please don't interrupt. I'm chairing this meeting. I'll share it in the fashion that I see fit and proper. So, please don't interrupt. As I said before, I've given all the committee plenty of latitude to ask questions and ask supplementary questions. Please, and I'll say it only one more time, and if I have to say it again, I'll exclude you from the room. Matthew, thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeff. And thank you, committee.
I'd now like to call Simon Westrop, Head of Legal Services at NewsQuest. Thank you.
The silver button, so
just the
silver one on the bottom. That's it.
Yes, I'm happy to say just a few words if it helps to put a framework on this for the NewsQuest Media Group. I'm a head of legal NewsQuest Media Group, and it's just the world low. The council proposes to publish its own monthly newsletter, divert public monies to finance it. When spending public money, the council has a duty obviously to act lawfully and responsibly. That includes considering the effect on local businesses, and also, of course, on the democratic principles underpinning local government. Government has got here before you, of course, was an issue with the Publicity Code in 2011, and the explanatory memorandum accompanying that code is actually just as interesting as the code itself, explaining some of the thinking behind it. I think we had to quote earlier from it, but it's worth quoting again. The department considers that a key element of localism is giving the public the information that they need to hold their council to account. This requires that information comes not just from the local authority, but also from independent sources. Local newspapers have traditionally been instruments for both holding councils to account themselves and giving the public the information they need to hold the councils to account. Ensuring that local newspapers are not the subject of unfair competition by local authority publications is the department considers in accord with localism. It goes on elsewhere. A healthy free press is important in providing information to the public to hold the local authority to account. So the memorandum quite clearly recognises that councils should be able to publicise their services where a gap in information is identified. But crucially, the whole point about the Publicity Code is that there has to be a balance. council newsletters should not look like newspapers in form or content, number one. Number two, council newsletters should not be published more frequently than quarterly. The council proposal says it's determined to comply with the first precept. That's great, but I guess you know, proof will be in the pudding at this point here. As for the second requirement, to print only quarterly, the council's proposal is just going to ignore that, seems to me. Print monthly, hope for the best. But if you kick away one of those precepts underlying the balance, you kick away the balance that the law, the code, provides so as to allow the council to use public money in this way in the first place. Acting in defiance of the code in this way doesn't strike us, at least, as the act of a responsible local authority. And we've been here before. Greenwich Borough Council, just a few months ago, abandoned a similar position, faced with injunction by the government and mounting legal costs. Why go down this expensive, well-travelled road when we know it leads to a dead end? I think I heard Councillor Patrick mentioning Tower Hamlets happening. My recollection is that the newsletter has gone, not before it did serious damage to these London advertising, not one of our things. Given as well the distorting effect of a local newspaper market, of a council newsletter, competing with advertising, there's going to be additional concerns about unlawful conduct in the UK competition law, quite apart from the Publicity Code. The impact on local publishers will be real and damaging, and no doubt about that. The council says it will direct its own council advertising and take third-party advertising in direct competition with existing commercial providers. But the local market is already saturated, as I think has been pointed out, and highly competitive. The intervention of a publicly funded competitor with no commercial constraints who can undercut existing publishers where margins are already very tight means that the damage and effect will be immediate and serious. The managing director locally for Newsquest anticipates lost revenues of some £90,000 or more. The awful irony of that is that it will lead to cuts in jobs quite probably and the services we can provide to our readers and our customers. So the effect of the council's intervention in this case would actually be a reduction in the plurality of local media and a reduction in the resources for communication to local people. Quite the opposite of what we're trying to achieve. If the council is really sincere in wanting better communications, then rather than working against local business and the wider interests of the local community, the better answer, it seems to us, is that the council should work with us to use existing resources even more efficiently and plug any gaps in provision that there might be. I know the managing director and my colleague, Hayden Smith, has some clear ideas on this. We're only too pleased to discuss them with the council so that we can cooperate, work together, and make some progress on that issue. Stop there.
Thank you. Lots of people indicating they would like to ask questions. Thank you. Rob?
Standpoint from the part of what the cabinet member said previously, so what has been not get information about the council.
I understand that, that's what the publicity
is. Even if they used existing mechanisms that are there, there's still a lot of.
I understand what you're saying, but let the gentleman answer the question.
I think actually that was the point because I was trying to make my piece. Here is the balance. Going to be a third world, but the publicity code is trying to strike a balance where a gap in provision is identified, short public money might be spent in compliance with the publicity code, but we need to observe the provisions of the code to ensure that the balance is observed and the local newspapers, healthy local free press is preserved because, as I say, because of the competitive local market, margins are very tight. So, competing third-party, publicly funded organisation is in this way is equally known as people's name.
Thank you, Sam.
Communication.
application that's the case. I said that there are numerous organisations reporting in this area. No, I don't think that's the case at all. As regards unfair competition, if you are taking third-party advertisers and competing for those advertisers, as the proposal envisages, that is direct competition.
Dave.
Thank you, Chair. If I may, I know your opening speech was quite involved. Could you expand a bit more on the reason why happily and those other places were refused or turned down legal and the reasons why they were turned down?
I think most of it comes down quite simply, as I understand it, their failure to comply with the requirement for quarterly publication. That certainly was the principal issue.
Quarterly was the main point.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Chris,
would
you like to ask a question?
Thank you, Chairman. So Simon, put a question you might not be able to ask, but it would be answered, but it needs to be asked. If this goes ahead and this council plans forward with distributing a monthly news sheet, whatever you want to call it, will NewsQuest lodge a legal case against them?
I wouldn't like to anticipate what we would do, but as I say, my inquiries of the local management here indicate that the threat is very serious, and we would have to consider all the options that are available.
Thank you, Mr. Westrop. I was particularly interested, obviously, to hear from yourself talking from a legal point of view. I mean, this council clearly has the cabinet anyway have identified that they believe there's a gap in provision in getting news out to local residents. If a council were to come to you, would you be able then to sit down with them if they could demonstrate to you that there was a gap, and then working together, hopefully you would be able to plug that gap? That was just one question. And then the second one again, if you would just remind me again, because perhaps it's unfair to ask you this, and clearly if it's uncomfortable then clearly you won't answer, but I find it extremely perverse of a council who are actually believing that their first priority is jobs and opportunity.
You mentioned a number of cases where councils have had rulings against them on the basis of this code. Can you confirm these cases took place
council was defending its position, in fact, settled with the government in the
So in the case took place. And what about
it? It took place, like a government withdrew from the Julian community.
And you mentioned a second one as well, a second case.
It wasn't a case, but it was mentioned by Councillor Patrick. As I said, Tower Hamlet was a seat, or I suppose I said it was a Tower Hamlet, so actually seat position that newsletter, not before it was quite a lot of damage to London advertising.
Okay, so clarifying my mind has been the case brought forward, that's been part of this and elsewhere. Well, so my mind, no case is not
well, well, it's not going to court because it's going to go against the
No, I understand. Okay, I'm not going to debate that. You mentioned that word, there's a gap in provision. Councillors can fill that gap so long as it's in a kind of reasonable way, a level way. By the court, then it's highlighted as a gap, 71% of households, by their figures, it'd be interesting how they came to that figure, and then you can't answer that. So there's a gap of 29% in nominal figures. Surely the council then can fill this gap.
Because it recognises that there's a need to publicise council services, and where there's a need, it can do so, provided it deserves the publicity.
On page 14 of the recording document, it's mentioned actually that case law about what type of guard the code needs has recently been reviewed. I understand from this that councils don't have to follow that code, they just have to give reason as to why they've departed. I also understand that there's no statutory requirement to have a guard for the code. And that you've all read the report, so I won't read all of it. The Secretary of State cannot enforce compliance. That's what my understanding is. Could you comment on that?
That's what the Secretary of State can enforce compliance if you're in injunction. That's exactly what was happening.
And there are aspects. Well, they didn't. They didn't go to the case. They didn't go to the court. Didn't go to court, and that's the actual case. So, and my other comments. No statutory requirement to have a guard.
Well, that's a question of law. I'm not sure really if we want to discuss whether there are reasons here. You must certainly have a guard to the code. And ignoring one of its key provisions is not sufficient.
Thank you, Chair. I'm going to make the point that the evidence has been on a legal basis. The PAC makes reference to all the legal evidence. So.
Steve.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Chair. I know some of the questions recently have been asked by the City Council to the future and you can't answer. But from a legal aspect, what could be the consequence to Wirral Council should they knowingly breach the code?
I don't know. You would certainly jointly prevent it from publishing a newsletter, and you would probably be required to pay both your own legal costs and the legal costs of the government. That would be the minimum.
Thank I'd now like to call the the second witness, Hayley Smith, who is the group editor at NewsQuest. Thank you. Therefore,
going back to your first point, I'm not saying that there's not been any discussion at all. There was, have been discussion with my managing director, who has expressed his concern over the, this proposal. But we would welcome further communication to discuss it. In terms of distribution, I'm not an expert, but I can only give the example that I've given, which is a separate publication inserted into the paper and distributed and run on copies. So you could effectively, if you wanted to distribute to homes, it is possible. And my point, I guess, would be, why does it need to be a monthly newspaper? You know, there are ways of people involved without having to do that.
Hey, are you using your microphone?
Sorry.
One more question, because we heard Mr. Westrup talking about potential loss of jobs. Would there also be a potential loss in distribution areas?
Yes, obviously it affects our ability to distribute. The reason I guess we've had to cut distribution in the past, as you know, it's widely publicised that the local media has been going through difficult periods. We are a commercial business as well as a free newspaper, a community newspaper, and there would be an effect. There would be an effect on our distribution, and which means that readers would be less informed than they were before, less informed by impartial, trustworthy press. Some of our distributors